Good day, brethren. We have a very intense video for you today from the series Truth and Creation. Just as we did in parts 1 and 2, we will observe the truth of God and His gospel for man by examining the life cycle of the species of fish known as the salmon. For it is within all the cycles and processes which the Lord has in His matchless foresight and knowledge installed within all His creation, do we find wisdom and truth that will humble us, encourage us, convict us, and equip us, and empower our faith in Him. Amen. I really enjoy telling you about the dragonfly and the butterfly, for within the life cycles of these little fellows, we have observed great and relevant truth to add to our faith walk home. However, I must confess to you that this teaching in particular about the salmon, I am excited about, for if we can remember this reality which we're about to bring forth, we will have a weapon in our hands to use against the wiles of the devil and the opposition that the born-again believer will always be contending against until the day of the Lord or these bodies finally die, whichever happens first. And if I may say that this is nothing new, all this is in the Bible. It's just that modern man has seemed to lose touch with the realities which are contained in this Holy Bible. All right, so let us begin now to observe the life cycle of the salmon. There are several types of Pacific salmon. However, we will just focus on the generalities concerning this fish. Depending upon your perception, there are really about 7 or 8 stages to a salmon's existence. And of course, every stage is packed with great significance. Obviously, the first stage for the Pacific salmon is the egg. Isn't it amazing to observe that this is always the same? In all things, in all of creation, everything, seen or unseen, every living thing always begins as a seed or as an egg, and nothing in this realm which the Lord has made just comes out of nowhere. It begins as a seed or an egg. Even creation itself, before God spoke it all into existence, before there was light, before there was grass or beast or chickens or man himself, all were a seed or an egg in the heart and mind of God. So, back to the salmon now. The salmon eggs are usually found in fairly shallow and calm streams. You will find salmon eggs hidden under gravel and sediment in the river or creek bed. You can expect to find as many as 2,000 to 8,000 eggs, depending upon the species of the salmon. In that cozy and tucked away spot, these eggs are awaiting to be hatched, though only about 1/5 of these eggs will likely hatch. Now, depending upon the species of the salmon and the water temperature, these fertilized eggs will not hatch for about 6 to 12 weeks, that is a month and a half to 3 months. Near the end of this stage, however, you will actually be able to see the form of the fish inside the egg. You will especially notice his eyes. You will see his little black eyes through the egg. Some experts call this point of the stage eyed eggs. Once stage 2 for the salmon rolls around, that is, when it is time for these little fellows or ladies to hatch, not only will they come out of these eggs, but the egg itself, the egg sac, the yolk sac, will actually remain attached to their bodies. For it is so that inside the egg, which is attached to their body, that these newborn fish, which are called by some experts alevin, yes, these alevin will literally absorb or imbibe the nutrients and sustenance necessary for them to grow in this short stage of their life. These baby salmon, or alevin, which are still very, very tiny, will stay fairly tucked away in this spot where mama dug out with her tail. They will absorb this yolk sac for about 2 to 3 weeks, where they will eventually enter the third stage of their existence. Now, once the yolk sac, which was filled with proteins and sugars and nutrients, is fully absorbed into the baby salmon, no longer shall he be called an alevin. Believe me, I am sure that he is glad to lose that title. But he will be promoted to what the experts now call a fry. I believe he will soon grow weary of this title as well, eh? Indeed, once the yolk sac is absorbed and he is changed, he will now begin to leave his hatching place and swim around in the current of the shallow and mild stream. He, the fry, will now begin to eat little tiny invertebrate, that is, little tiny water creatures without a spinal column, like worms or insects. And you may find this shocking, but nonetheless, these fry actually will eat the dead carcasses of their parents for sustenance. This is something we will discuss in a little more detail later on, for there is great significance in this truth. In this stage of the salmon's life cycle, these fry are extremely skittish. They master the skill of fleeing and hiding from predators, and rightfully so, for they are still very small yet. Also, at this point, you may easily observe these young fry live and interact with each other. They'll live and interact with other fry in a way that seems chaotic. However, as they grow in this stage, they will somehow begin to develop a unity with each other. They will learn how to school with each other. Somehow they will swim together in unison with one mind and of one accord. As they live and eat and grow together under the water, these fry, these baby salmon, will be united by a mysterious force that causes them to operate together in an organized manner. Now, after this fry begins to grow, he will enter the fourth stage of his life cycle. And this is an important phase for the salmon, you see, because he will eventually make his way into the salty waters of the ocean. But in order for him to make the circumstantial transition from freshwater to salt water, he must first undergo an internal change that enables him to live in the ocean, you see. So as the fry moves up the river toward the ocean, he will begin a process called smolting. And the salmon at this point is called by the experts a smolt. The smolt, or young salmon, will be found at this point dwelling in a place called an estuary. Now, an estuary is a partly enclosed body of brackish water. That means the water is a mixture of fresh river water and seawater, or salt water. The reason that this is the case is because an estuary is actually where several streams or rivers meet together at their endpoint, flowing into the ocean. Therefore, it is so that this estuary is subject to waves and tides from the ocean and an influx of salt water, yet also it is subject to the flow of fresh water with its sediments and microscopic life as well. Therefore, this estuary is a zone of transition. It is the portal between the two types of water environments. The smolt, or young salmon, will dwell in this place temporarily, for it is in this place that he will undergo the internal changes necessary for him to enter the salty ocean waters to live and move. For without this change in his kidneys and his body, he would surely die. Now, if I may point out something to you here, beloved, even in the spirit realm, there is a parallel to this estuary reality, and that is this. When the salmon are leaving the fresh waters to enter the salty oceans, they must linger here in this transition place until their organs transform enough to live completely immersed in the ocean's saltwater environment. This also is essentially what happens when a human, a man, a son of man, becomes alienated from the life of God. They are in a spiritual estuary where they undergo a process of conformity to the fallen nature internally, which enables them, get this, it enables them to live a life contrary to God. This part of the process for the salmon is extremely similar unto what happens to the souls of men when they are growing out of childhood into adolescence. You see, we as young children or young teenagers will go through a change, and unfortunately, not for the good. We literally come to a place known as what some call the age of accountability, where we fully understand that we are sinning against God, and we thus become dead unto God and alive unto sin, and we need to be born again, and the sooner the better. We literally, as humans, in that place, change on the inside. You see, because we are moving toward the ocean of the world, and we change. Our mind literally, in many areas, is given over to unclean passions and desires. As Romans chapter 1 says, given over to a debased mind to do those things that are not fitting. Our conscience then enters a war to try and sway us back to righteousness, yet we cannot help ourselves and end up moving further into ungodly mentalities and reasoning and all the unclean desires that go with it. But glory to Jesus Christ, for He is mighty to save us from this. Amen. This reality is much more obvious in some people's life than others. This process of the salmon going through this change represents the soul of man entering the ocean of unbelief and rebellion towards God Most High, and he will live only to please himself in this place. It is stated amongst many experts of the salmon that this stage of the salmon's life, when he is in the ocean, is the least understood and unknown part of his life cycle. Likewise, when these salmon finally decide to go back home to spawn, to lay eggs and fertilize eggs, they must go back the way that they came, and that means that they must enter the estuary portal again, where they must transform internally again, so they can live completely immersed within freshwater environments. You see, if the salmon were to just begin their journey without this internal change, they would not survive. Perhaps he could turn around and go back, or he would just die in the freshwater trying to function and live with saltwater organs still. Well, it is the same for a new born-again believer. For once he or she is born again, they essentially are in a spiritual estuary as well, where they are still subject to saltwater, or the world and the flesh. Yet, they also are subject to freshwater, or the kingdom of God and His Spirit. This is why at times we see new converts still behave in antichrist ways or still operate with carnal reasoning. They still may engage in old habits, for they are in a period of transition, and God is internally doing changes, enabling them to begin the hard journey home. If they really want to go on with God and swim home, those things that are contrary will fall off, disappear, and be replaced by godly reasoning and habits that promote a life of faith and victory with constant conformity to the nature and character of Jesus Christ. Amen. This is why we who are mature in certain areas must be very careful how we handle babes in Christ. We must be very prudent as to how we respond to them and correct them. We must keep them in prayer and be good examples, and trust God to remove certain things in His way and in His time. That does not mean, however, that we just continue to overlook wrong and sinful behaviors and reasonings. God will lead us into these situations tenderly and with godly wisdom to rebuke and restore. Now, back to the salmon. Our salmon friend will spend some time living in the Pacific Ocean, and you will find a great population of Pacific salmon widely distributed over the North Pacific and the Bering Sea near Alaska. They will live in the ocean for approximately 2 to 5 years, depending upon the species of salmon, until he or she becomes a physically mature adult. Then, something will take place within him yet again. He will be consumed by a drive to go back home. He will be drawn by an unseen force which will cause him to go back to where he came from. Oh dear friends, this fellow salmon will begin a process that will cost him his very life and personal will. Many a salmon do not make it back home. Many on the way are captured by predators and devoured. Many a salmon just can't endure the journey even. Only the strong and what some may call lucky will make it back to that place from which they were spawned. Now, these salmon, both male and female, begin a migration back to the very shallow and mild freshwater creek they were born in. Yet, in order for that to be possible, they must first go through another process. They must metamorph internally again, quite literally, a reversal of the very transformation they underwent to enter the salt waters of the ocean and live and dwell there. They will transform yet again inside. Their kidneys and organs and body will change back into a nature that will enable them to dwell again in fresh waters that they may swim the journey home. Now, if I may point out here also that many salmon do not even get to make it to this stage also, considering the fact that while they're living in the ocean, there's another predator that is always trying to get him. You see, because we eat salmon, do we not? So some salmon don't even get to make it back to this part of the process. They get killed in the ocean. Some men don't get to make it to the part of this journey either, for they get killed in their sins. Lord, have mercy on us. Now, my brethren, I want you to see an extremely valuable and life-altering reality, if it is heeded. That, namely this, these salmon are quite literally swimming upstream against the current and against the rapids just to get home, okay? They are swimming and fighting and battling their way back to the place of birth. They have to go through a lot of intense rapids, waterfalls, and contrary situations with various forms of opposition just to arrive at the sacred destination. They will have to be very sober and very vigilant, avoiding predators like bears and predatory birds like falcons or hawks or eagles. This really is an epic fight, indeed an epic microcosmic journey that man has not seemed to admire or absorb into his reality. What a thing to consider, this part of the salmon's life cycle. Brethren, if I could just expound a little here, for if we can accept this truth, it will enable us to really overcome all the satanic obstacles in our path. We will be able to live in victory over sin in all its forms, like bad attitudes, wrong desires, evil-mindedness, all the works of the flesh, unbelief. We will overcome sickness and disease, insanity and death, and we will be made useful to help others do the same. Amen. If we can remember this sound biblical truth, okay? Consider the turmoil and the tribulation of trying to swim up a river current where it is at all times and in all ways pushing against you, resisting you, and its very nature is utterly contrary to the direction you are traveling and the reasons why. I mean, come on, let us consider the fact that it would be a fight. Look, it would take all that a man has. It would be a cause that takes all that a created being has within its heart and apparently well beyond. well beyond what our fallen beings had within our hearts to win this battle. Yes, it would seem that in order to accomplish this task, some sort of augmentation or divine enablement, indeed a supernatural force outside of ourselves, is extremely necessary to achieve this seemingly impossible goal. If the salmon were to lose hope, lose drive, lose purpose, and stop fighting and give in to the raging current that is ever before him, he would get swept away and driven back to the ocean. And he would not reach the end. He would not make it back home, and his purpose would be unfulfilled. For the salmon who does reach it back home, he will have overcome large and jagged rocks at times, mean and violent predators. He will have overcome the very force itself that is always seeking to cause him to go back the wrong way. My dear friends, you must know by now. You must by now have come to realize this is indeed the life of a disciple of Jesus Christ, a child of God, as he thus travels the narrow road home. Did not Jesus say unto us, strive to enter the narrow gate? For many, I say to you, will seek to enter, but will not be able. Is it not written that through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God? Are we not told to lay hold of eternal life and fight the good fight of faith? Is this not this world in which we live, this very age, this culture that we dwell in, so very contrary to the will and nature and kingdom of God? It is. Therefore, to the man or woman who gets born again and is swimming home to God, will they not be ever fighting up a river current and waterfalls of worldly ideas and philosophies and desires? Is not the man or woman of God literally fighting a fight on the inside of their bodies and minds, where there is a force within them that devils are trying to appeal to that would cause them to give in to the desires and the pains and the ideas that will cause them to be carried away back to the ocean of sin and death? Is it not written that the flesh lusts against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh, and these two are contrary one to another? And also, is it not written that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavens? The Epistle of Jude, he tells us in it to contend earnestly for the faith which was delivered to us. This walk of faith, my brethren, is an epic fight that will last till the last day of our existence in these bodies. And in this way, our new life in Christ is like this stage of the salmon's life cycle. Therefore, it is ever a constant and intense fight to be loyal to God, to love God, to read and meditate upon His Word. A most noble battle indeed, to remain in prayer, to stoop down to our knees and remain humble before the Lord thy God, to praise and worship him with songs and hymns, to be ever thankful and forgiving to others. A hard battle to be a loving light in the darkness, to resist the devil and the world, to preach and proclaim and declare the truth with all boldness to mean depraved men and governments, and not back down like a coward. Indeed, an epic fight to follow Jesus and believe him till the end. Hallelujah. But praise God, the Lord told us himself, in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, says the Lord. I have overcome the world. Amen. Since therefore our Lord Jesus has won this epic battle of faith once as a man, he is thus qualified to do it again through us. Yes, he will do it through each and every believer who believes on him for eternal life. Amen. But I want you to understand something. This does not go without saying that we will not have rest and comfort on the way. For in the same way that these salmon do indeed find rest and protection on their journey, for they hide behind rocks and rock formations where the current is not a threat, and they rest there and recuperate there. For it is written that our God is the Father of mercy and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions, amen, that we may also comfort those with the same comfort with which we are comforted by our Father, amen. Also, we can see that sometimes on their way home, that the current and force of the river is less intense and aggressive in some areas, and they can slow down and rest. Yes, thankfully, they at times will not have to swim as hard and steady. In the same way, the Lord will guide us into rest and consolation. We will enter into times of divine ease. Praise the Lord. And when it is time to move into rough waters again, we will have faith and grace to stand and resist the wiles of the devil and the flesh and the world. Amen. So, once the diligent salmon make their way back to the spot of hatching, when they arrive back to the very place they themselves were born, and what a miracle that is to begin with. Glory to God. They are now driven to do one thing and one thing only. The female, her number one goal is to lay her eggs. The male, his number one goal is to thus fertilize her eggs. The female will use her tail to dig out a spot in the gravel or sediments of the stream or creek, perhaps near a safe place like a rock. And once she digs that spot out, she will lay her eggs there, thousands of them. Then the male, her partner, will move in to fertilize the eggs with a substance that experts call milt, or just very plainly, salmon sperm. Now, once this is complete, the mama will then sort of cover that spot up with sediment and gravel, using her tail again, as a means to hide and protect from predators who would eat them. And thus, a job well done. Mission complete. Yet, mommy and daddy's purpose is not yet fulfilled at this point. Brethren, no doubt we could have a ceremony for these salmon moms and dads, and we would hear words uttered something like this. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You have trudged and battled your way back to this place to perform this divine purpose. You have laid down your life to the uttermost. You have escaped the paw of the bear and the beaks and talons of violent birds. You have overcome the rapids and the waterfalls, and you have not lost faith. Enter into the joy of your Lord. And a crown of glory, a crown of life and majesty will be placed upon these salmon's heads, and they would bow their heads and cry and weep with joy and humility. And they would say, while flinging the crowns off of their heads back at the feet of the Lord God, and they would say unto him, Nay, O Lord, we were not able to do these things in our strength or will, nay, not even in our own intellect or wisdom. But Lord, all glory and praise and victory belongs to you and you alone, O Lord God. For you, Lord Jesus, have overcome, and it was your grace that was sufficient for us to make it to this place. Amen. Has not our Lord said, He who overcomes shall inherit all things. He who endures to the end shall be saved. Amen. Brethren, these overcoming salmon, these salmon who were more than conquerors, have one more purpose to complete. It is a testimony to the reality of the legacy that one can leave behind. These salmon will die. Yet, even in and through their death on the earth, they will be still helping thrust their offspring into the divinely orchestrated cycle they just completed themselves. How so? When these little salmon hatch from their eggs and the alevin stage is complete for them and they become a fry, they will literally eat the bodies of their parents for food and sustenance. Not only that, but as the body of the parents decay, their bodies also thus play a role in the maintenance and preservation of the physical environment around them. the earth and water receive and absorb their bodies into it. Now, this is comparable to what happens when a true saint, a true man or woman of God, their time is up in the earth and they die. Their bodies die. The life they lived, the faith they had in the Lord, their body of work in Christ, if indeed it was spirit and not flesh, will still remain in the earth, and other believers, other new disciples, other children of God will feed from that body of work and go forth to essentially do the same thing. For it is the life of Christ, the grace of God that lives on eternally and is transferred to every believer. And this will contribute to the life of the church in the earth. And this is so, for Jesus himself was the first one to make this grueling trip upstream and die. And we thus feed off of his flesh and his blood and his life force, so that we too may overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil. Amen. Well, my brothers and sisters, I hope that you have indeed heard and been able to receive truth today. And I hope that you can apply to your fight of faith to make it home to be with the Lord. For he has thus told us, we must take up our cross daily, deny ourselves, and follow him. He said, he who serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. And my Father will honor him. You see, we must follow Jesus. That means thinking like Jesus and reasoning like Jesus. We must be driven and motivated by the things that Jesus is thus motivated by and moved by. And we must win like Jesus. We must overcome all things like him. And we will do it by him and through him. And then we will be with him. And he will be with us, even along the way. And then we will arrive at the life at the end thereof, and thus be with the Lord forever. Amen. Brethren, grace and peace and love be with you. Amen.